Hey Tech Defenders, welcome back to Ton Does Linux and More, and so much more hardware and desktop environment news that my head is still spinning. So grab your favorite beverage, settle in, and let's dive deep into everything that happened in Linux land this week. Trust me, you're going to want to stick around for this one. All right, let's kick things off with the big kernel news, because Linus Torvalds just dropped Linux 6.17 RC1 a few hours ahead of his typical schedule. And the reason? He's currently in Europe. Now, this marks the end of the Linux 6.17 merge window, and folks, this is going to be huge for Ubuntu 25.10 and other late 2025 distribution releases. So what's actually new in 6.17? Well, buckle up, because there's a lot to unpack here. First up, Intel Xe3 graphics for Panther Lake are now enabled by default. That's massive news for anyone planning to grab one of those new Intel laptops later this year. But that's just the beginning. We're getting standardized key code support for the performance boost key on relevant laptops. You know that key that never quite worked right? Yeah, that one's finally getting proper Linux support. The gconfig kernel configuration editor has been updated to GTK3, finally bringing it into the modern era. We're seeing various file system performance improvements across the board. More Rust language additions, continuing that trend we've been watching, and something called attack vector controls that makes it way easier for system administrators to manage CPU security mitigations. For the gamers out there, we are getting SRIOV support for Intel BattleMage graphics cards, plus multi-GPU prep work for something called Project Battle Matrix, which sounds absolutely epic, by the way. And of course, new ARM and RISC-V SoC support, because Linux just keeps expanding to more hardware. Now, here's where things get interesting and a bit controversial. Bcachefs, that file system we've been following, had a pull request submitted with new feature code, but it wasn't merged. And here's the kicker. There are suggestions that Linus might actually remove Bcachefs from the mainline kernel in Linux 6.18. The RISC-V feature changes also got rejected this cycle, which is another notable upset for that community. Linux 6.17 stable should be out around the end of September or early October if they need an extra release candidate. But honestly, with all these features, this is shaping up to be one of the most significant kernel releases we've seen in a while. Now, let's talk about the absolute monster release of the week, Debian 13 Trixie. After 2 years, 1 month, and 30 days of development, the Debian project has officially released their new stable version, and this thing is packed with updates. We're talking about over 14,100 new packages, bringing the total count to 69,830 packages. Over 8,800 packages were removed as obsolete, and 44,326 packages got updated. The overall disk usage is 403 gigabytes, made up of over 1.4 billion lines of code. Let me put that in perspective. That's more code than some entire operating systems. Debian 13 ships with multiple desktop environments. GNOME 48, KDE Plasma 6.3, LXDE 13, LXQT 2.1.0, and XFCE 4.20. So whatever your desktop preference, Debian's got you covered. The software updates are absolutely massive. We're getting Apache 2.4.64, the latest Bash 5.2.37, BindDNS Server 9.20, GNU Compiler Collection 14.2, GIMP 3.0.4. Yes, GIMP 3 is finally here in a stable release. LibreOffice 25.2, and here's the big one, Linux Kernel 6.12 LTS Series. Now, architecture support is where things get really interesting. Debian 13 officially supports 7 architectures, including, for the first time ever, 64-bit RISC-V. That's huge for the RISC-V community. But here's the flip side. i386 is no longer supported as a regular architecture. There's no official kernel or installer for i386 systems anymore. And this is the last release for the ARML architecture. So if you're running ARM EABI systems, you'll want to start planning your migration strategy. For cloud users, Debian 13 is available across all major platforms, Amazon EC2, Microsoft Azure, OpenStack, and more. They've really made sure this release is accessible everywhere. Speaking of distribution updates, Ubuntu 24.04.3 LTS also dropped this week with enhanced hardware support. They've backported Linux kernel 6.14 from Ubuntu 25.04. So you're getting that newer hardware support without having to jump to a development release. And Linux Mint 22.2 is currently in beta testing, so Mint users have something to look forward to in the coming weeks. Let's shift gears and talk desktop environments, because KDE had a busy week. KDE Plasma 6.4.4 dropped on August 5th as a bug fix update, and while it might sound like just another point release, there are some really nice improvements here. The notification system got some love, Flatpak support is better than ever, and there are various improvements and bug fixes throughout. But the really exciting stuff is coming in Plasma 6.5, which is highlighting new Bluetooth and Wi-Fi toggles, FlatHub URL support directly in Discover, and faster firmware updates. That last one is particularly nice because firmware updates have always been a bit of a pain point in Linux, so anything that makes that process smoother is a win in my book. On the GNOME side, GNOME 48 is making waves with what they're calling a reimagined experience. We're getting smoother settings, which honestly was needed because the old settings app could be a bit clunky. Glorious HDR support, finally, and precision scaling enhancements. That HDR support is particularly exciting because it's been one of those features that Windows and macOS users have had for years, and Linux users have been waiting for. It's great to see GNOME finally catching up in that department. Speaking of graphics, Mesa 25.2 updates are rolling out, which means better graphics performance across the board, regardless of which desktop environment you're using. But it's not just desktop environments getting updates. We're seeing significant application updates across the ecosystem. GIMP 3.0.4 is finally stable and shipping with distributions. Inkscape 1.4 brings new features for digital artists, and LibreOffice 25.2 continues to be the office suite that just keeps getting better. For developers, the toolchain updates are impressive. We're getting LLVM Clang Toolchain 19 as the default, with 17 and 18 still available. Python 3.13 is now the standard. Rust 1.85 brings the latest language improvements, and the GNU Compiler Collection 14.2 ensures you've got the latest and greatest compilation tools. What I love about this is that Linux distributions are really staying current with development tools. You're not stuck with ancient versions like you might be on some other platforms. Systemd 257 is also part of this wave of updates, and while Systemd updates don't always get people excited, this one includes some nice improvements for system management and service handling. Now let's talk hardware support, because this week brought some significant driver updates that you definitely want to know about. NVIDIA released their Linux X64 display driver 570.181 on August 5th. And AMD followed up with Radeon software for Linux 25.10.2.1 on August 6th. For gamers, these driver updates are crucial because they often include performance improvements and bug fixes for the latest games. And with Linux gaming continuing to grow, we hit 3% on Steam recently. Every driver improvement matters. Here's a fun piece of hardware news that made me chuckle. After 16 years, someone finally proposed a patch to improve Linux support for the Logitech G13 game board. 16 years, that's dedication to the long game right there. With Linux gaming becoming more popular, it makes sense that people are dusting off their old gaming peripherals and wanting proper Linux support. Linux 6.1.17 is extending Soundwire support to upcoming AMD ACP 7.2 hardware, which is great news for audio enthusiasts and anyone working with professional audio setups. But here's some concerning news from the Intel front. Additional Intel Linux drivers have been left orphaned, and maintainers have been let go. This is part of Intel's broader cost-cutting measures, but it's worrying for the Linux community because Intel has traditionally been one of the better hardware vendors when it comes to Linux support. Speaking of concerning news, we need to talk about CVE-2025-38236. This is a severe Linux kernel vulnerability discovered by Google Project Zero researcher Jan Horn, and it allows attackers to gain full kernel-level control. This is the kind of vulnerability that keeps system administrators up at night. If you're running Linux systems, especially in production, you need to make sure you're staying on top of security updates. On a more positive note, Ubuntu 24.04.3 LTS brings enhanced hardware support through that backported 6.14 kernel I mentioned earlier. This means better support for newer hardware without having to jump to a development release. There have also been some struggles reported with the latest kernel updates and firmware updates for Linux kernel drivers, particularly around suspend battery drain issues. It's a reminder that while Linux hardware support keeps getting better, there are still occasional bumps in the road. Let's wrap up the technical news with some community highlights, because the Linux ecosystem is so much more than just code. It's about the people and organizations making it all happen. The Linux Foundation announced a partnership with ATIS to advance development and integration of open-source Open RAN technologies. This might sound technical, but it's actually about making telecommunications infrastructure more open and interoperable. The Open Source Security Foundation is hosting Open SSF Community Day Europe 2025 on August 28th in Amsterdam. Given that security vulnerability we just talked about, events like this are more important than ever. Alma Linux held their Alma Linux Day Vancouver event on August 9th, focusing on VFX applications. It's great to see Linux distributions building communities around specific use cases like visual effects and film production. MX Linux is preparing for MX25 with some significant changes coming. While they haven't revealed all the details yet, they've been teasing that this will be a major update to their distribution. And speaking of milestones, OpenSUSE is celebrating their 20th anniversary. 20 years of have a lot of fun. That's quite an achievement in the fast-moving world of Linux distributions. For the enterprise and home lab folks, Proxmox VE 9.0 was released, bringing new features for virtualization and container management. What I love about all these community updates is that they show how diverse and vibrant the Linux ecosystem really is. Whether you're into gaming, enterprise computing, visual effects, telecommunications, or just tinkering at home, there's a Linux community for you. Wow, what a week, right? We've covered Debian 13's massive release after over 2 years of development, Linux kernel 6.17-RC1 with Intel Xe3 graphics and potential Bcachefs drama, critical security vulnerabilities you need to patch, desktop environment updates from both KDE and GNOME, significant driver updates from NVIDIA and AMD, and a thriving community that just keeps pushing Linux forward. The pace of Linux development continues to amaze me. Every week brings new features, better hardware support, and innovations that make our favorite operating system even better. If you found this roundup helpful, smash that like button, subscribe if you haven't already, and ring that notification bell so you never miss the latest Linux news. I put out these weekly roundups every Tuesday, plus deep dives on specific topics throughout the week. Drop a comment below and let me know, which of these updates are you most excited about? Are you planning to upgrade to Debian 13? Are you worried about that kernel security vulnerability? I read every comment and often turn your questions into future videos. Thanks for watching, Tech Defenders, and I'll see you in the next one. Keep exploring, keep learning, and remember, in the world of Linux, there's always something new to discover.